Ambition is a double-edged sword. Sometimes it works out great, pure smooth sailing, nothing but sunshine and rainbows. This project though, I came to discover exactly why no one has tried to do what I'm trying to do. I'm getting ahead of myself though, we'll get to all that. Let's start the video like I start any project, full of optimism. Project in question is fairly straightforward, a simple set of shelves consisting of three parts: the boards, the legs, and the pins. We're gonna start with the legs and a setup I think you haven't seen before, probably because it's a bad idea. The reason we need this absurd idea is our leg stock is round rod and we need a consistent finish. Normally you'd achieve this using a hand drill. In this case though, the stock is too big, long, and heavy. So 3D printing comes to our rescue with a drill adapter to handle the larger diameter and a bearing block to deal with the length and weight. Now, I know what you're saying. There's no way that actually works. I thought the same thing, or at least I gave it 50-50. It actually worked. Although, I did go through like 5 drill adapters to do all 6 legs. Still, I consider that a win. Our stock is prepped. Time to make some holes. First, we need to drill and tap the ends of the legs for adjustable feet. Once we do that, well, we need to make the adjustable feet. Now you can buy adjustable feet, but they always look so out of place. So to save us from that shame, we're gonna make them from the same size stock as the legs themselves. All we need to do is turn down and thread a stem, which would be super easy if I had a lathe. I do have a milling machine though, and if you don't think about it and squint, basically the same thing. They both spin stuff. While we have the lathe warmed up, we might as well knock out the other turned parts, the pins, which are made of 3/8 brass. All we need to do is sand through the grits to get a nice luster and hit the ends with a 3-degree taper. This tapered feature is something you'll see used throughout the entire build. Now, like my other setups, this one is equally janky. We're fighting the limits of using a mill as a lathe. We have way too much part sticking out, which creates butt-puckering levels of deflection. Luckily, that taper is purely cosmetic, and a little bit of sanding will hide this crime. To the hard part, drilling the holes that will make the legs and pins one forever. The holes need to be a precise diameter, no slop allowed, and the spacing between each hole needs to be spot on. On top of all that, each hole needs to be drilled at a 45-degree angle. So once again, we're going to rely on 3D printing to produce our setup. The head of the mill is at 45 degrees. I have an angle finder with a custom housing to clock the hole 90 degrees from the previous hole. I'm using 2 stop blocks and a piece of scrap to create the space between each hole. The exact distance between each hole does not matter. What matters is that the spacing is consistent between holes. So all that just to get the part ready to be drilled. To actually drill, we're gonna start with a 1/4-inch end mill. We need to use the end mill because at 45 degrees, the side of my drills contact the part first instead of the center. So we have to start the hole with an end mill. After that, we can spot drill, pilot drill, 3/8 end mill, final drill, and ream to final size. Now I can feel your judgmental stare. I know you shouldn't use a drill chuck with an end mill, and you really shouldn't use one at an angle. On the other hand, I have 36 holes to drill, and each one requires 6 operations, which is math, so nobody got time to be swapping collets. Not to mention, after I drill all 36 holes, I need to deburr and sand all 36 holes. Thank you. touches on the metal parts include applying cold blue and a bit of paste wax, as well as giving the leg ends a slight chamfer, similar to the taper we added to the ends of the pins. After that, we're done with the metal work. Or at least I thought I was. The final part for the shelf build is, well, the shelf part, which we will be making out of wood. Specifically, they will be made from etimo, also known as African rosewood. Etimo grows in parts of Central and Western Africa. The trees grow to huge heights, up to 165 feet and 6 feet in diameter. With any exotic, you need to be conscious of its sustainability, and exotic woods should never be used in anything that is mass produced. Etimo is not endangered, but is listed as vulnerable, primarily because the wood is commonly harvested to produce rubber. The idea that this amazing wood is being turned into rubber is honestly kind of mind-boggling. You know, like when your mind's stuck in a bottle? This batch of wood in particular is unique because it's a mix of plain sawn, riff sawn, and quarter sawn. Each has its own unique look and characteristics. After a bit of planing, jointing, gluing, and sanding, we have our finished panels ready to go on the CNC. You never need a CNC, but man, is it nice to have. In this case, it really helps, as each panel has 6 1-inch holes. These holes need to be perfectly aligned from one panel to the next. And when I say perfect, I mean perfect. Any amount of misalignment will create serious problems during final assembly. Along with the holes, the underside of each shelf has a 3-degree taper, similar to the taper we did on the ends of the brass pins. After all, why make the bottom the same as the top? Once the robot is done doing all the hard work for us, we need to smooth out the underside. The CNC leaves little ridges we need to knock down with a hand plane. Now, I actually like the look of the ridges that the CNC leaves, but ultimately, I decided it wasn't the right look for this project. After hand planing, the whole thing gets sanded through the grits. Final touch is a slight chamfer on the top edge, again, similar to the chamfers on the steel legs and the taper on the pins. Okay, so everything has been leading up to this moment. It's time for final assembly. Unlike most of my projects though, where I leave the easy parts for last, this one has the hardest part last. What makes it so challenging is we still need to drill the angled holes in the shelves that the brass pins will go through. These holes need to be drilled in place to ensure perfect alignment. So we basically need to assemble the shelves so we can then assemble the shelves. So shocker here, we're gonna rely on an overly complicated jig. Although this time I used a combination of CNC parts and 3D printed parts. I have a set of boxes that will hold both the shelves and legs into position. That taper on the bottom of the shelves is definitely making my life harder here, but I still like it. The real trick is the 3D print has a hardened drill bushing pressed into it. That coupled with an alignment pin ensures the holes are spot on. Once everything is clamped and triple checked, we can drill and ream the holes to final size. After that, we just hammer the pins home and we can remove the alignment bushings. Now rinse and repeat this 30 times without making any mistakes and we'll be solid. Or not. At this point in the build, I'm an absolute nervous wreck. I've spent months worth of weekends and way too much money on this project. Yet I genuinely don't know if it'll work at all. In theory, it should work. I've racked my brain for weeks on how it could fail. Now, I did start to get optimistic as the pins started to slide into place. One after the other, just like I had planned, the jig was working. It was a huge win. I thought I was in the clear, and that by the end of the day, I could move on with my life. But the closer I got to the end, the further I sank into depression. You see, the whole idea behind the assembly was that it would be super flimsy at first, which is why I needed the scaffolding thingamajig to hold it in place. As I move up through and get more pins installed, the shelves should become stiffer and rigid. Well, as you probably can see from the video, that is not happening. In fact, as I'm hammering the final pins home, this thing is wobbling all over the place. Like, so much wobble, I'm almost impressed if I wasn't so depressed. In fact, I briefly considered just scrapping the whole project and quitting. We always do this. We add unnecessary pressure onto ourselves with arbitrary deadlines. The project will take as long as it takes. My first idea to fix the wobble is straightforward. Add epoxy to all the joints. I wanted to keep the joints dry for disassembly and transport, but I kind of always knew that was a pipe dream. The process is simple. Knock the pins back out, apply the epoxy, tap it back in, clean up the excess. The epoxy helped a fair bit. To keep going, I decided to add some horizontal steel rods to help link the legs together. Although, this does mean hand drilling through steel, which is never an enjoyable experience. The holes need to align precisely, so for the 10 millionth time, we need a 3D printed jig. This jig consists of two clamping blocks that attach to each leg and some steel square tube. The square tube helps align the two clamping blocks. The second part is a series of drill inserts. The trick here is the drill inserts can be hot swapped, so I can pilot drill, final drill, and ream both legs without ever breaking down the setup. This ensures the holes will align. Well, it would have if I had taken my time. A couple of the holes misaligned by a few degrees, but some smacks with a hammer brought it all back into alignment. Usually does. The real pain here was the fact that the thing was shaking all over the place as I drilled the legs. Horizontal rods really don't seem to be helping. And I'm starting to realize why this thing is actually wobbling all over the place. The shelves are simply too narrow for how long and tall they are. This is compounded by the fact that the legs are inset from the edges, when in reality they need to flare out at the bottom. So at this point, the only solution is going to be wall-mounted brackets. Now, I really wanted this thing to be freestanding, but that ship has sailed. Like a lot of my hopes and dreams. Although, they do just work as is. I did briefly consider just using them. To make the wall brackets, we're going to use the same brass pin design. We really just need to machine a brass flange to connect the pins to the wall. So back to the lathe we go. This time we're not pushing it in terms of length, but rather diameter. After a dozen or so passes, we get down to our flange. Add a couple chamfered holes and chamfers. The whole thing gets pinned and screwed to the wall, and with that we're golden. So finally, we can throw some finish on the wood and call this project finished. Now this project is hands down one of my best, so it really shouldn't be a surprise that it was so much of a challenge. After any struggle, I always think to myself, I should take a break. That lasts like 2 days before I get bored, and I'm right back to consuming myself with new project ideas, two of which I want to show you now. The first design is a couch, which will actually be made from a live edge slab. It's going to have some very unique joinery, and we'll be able to dive into some upholstery work. My second concept is for a floor lamp. This one has a good amount of machining in it, and will feature a lampshade crafted from wood veneer. Let me know down below which one you want to see.